Hi everyone, Zoe here, Hasashi Buri desu ne. I know it's been a while since I've done one of these two-camera pieces, and I'm sorry, it's not that I haven't had several on the hoof, it's just that unfortunately they've all kind of stalled at various stages in the production process, whether it's researching, scripting, recording, editing the videos. One of the videos that I had started to do when it was timely is now so out of date and so non-topical that I probably won't bother finishing and releasing it. But of course, I've got other ideas, don't worry. I've got another one that's basically been three quarters finished for like 2 months now. But I just haven't had the spoons to finish it. And to be fair, I kind of fell into a deep depression in March. I don't know why. I'm usually fairly resilient, but things really got to me. The world and the future seemed very bleak. And like, I crawled out of that over the course of April, which I have it on good authority is the cruelest month, or at least so T.S. Eliot would tell me. And now it's May, and I'm looking at the calendar going, oh my God, it's already halfway through May. And it's the 17th, which is the International Day Against Homophobia, Transphobia, and Biphobia. The acronym is IDAHOBIT. And yes, before you ask, the OCD portion of my brain is also going, the order of the letters in the acronym doesn't match the order of the words in the title. It bothers me too. I didn't make the acronym, don't blame me. But what this has done is kind of said, maybe I can use this as a kick in the butt to get a video out, totally unscripted. I'm just talking off the top of my head, so this is gonna be chaotic. And then don't worry about polish, don't worry about perfection, just get back into the flow of it, get over the fear of releasing a video that may be full of gibberish. So here we go. So my plan is to basically tell you what IDAHOBIT is all about, and yes, it's a cute acronym, kind of crazy. And then use that as a springboard to talk about what recent events have been going on for trans rights here in the UK and their implications for LGBT rights moreover. And then I think we can finish with maybe an update, a four-year transition update. So let's get started, or this is going to take forever. So first off, what is IDAHOBIT? It originally was just Idaho, not the state in America, but rather International Day Against Homophobia, to commemorate the fact that on the 17th of May 1990, the World Health Organization finally removed homosexuality from the ICD, I'm sorry, the International Classification of Diseases. So just take a moment to let that sink in. As recently as 1990, if you were gay, you were deemed mentally ill. Yeah. Someone in the World Health Organization, and they finally got their heads together, said, you know what? This is a crazy idea, but I'm just going to like put this out here. What if, just what if, gay and lesbian people are just part of, you know, natural human variation? What if sexual orientation also falls on a spectrum and it's perfectly natural and not actually a mental disorder? A lot of usually far-right groups wish to go for a very narrow definition of what homophobia or transphobia is, and they would see it as, well, I'm not hurling rocks or bricks at a gay person. I'm not calling that trans woman a tranny. I'm not doing anything to harm them, and therefore I'm not homophobic or transphobic. But that's not actually a very complete definition of what these terms mean. If you accept the status quo narrative that
LGBT people are just not as good, somehow lesser than cishet people, that they're like incomplete or they're living lives that are just going to be worse on the basis of who they are.
Not on the basis of the discrimination they face. That would be a more valid determination. It's like, surely you could argue that it's like, wow, life's going to be hard for you because society is absolutely horrible towards LGBT people. Valid point. But if you're like going,
oh, your life's going to be kind of crappy because don't you understand it's just so much better to be, you know, heterosexual and cisgender. I mean, you'll just feel a more complete and you'll be able to live your life as you were intended to.
Then you might be homophobic or transphobic. I'm just going to throw that out there. So it's understanding that just because you don't feel you're being abusive or hateful or bigoted towards LGBT people, if you stand aside and let your coworkers and your family and people around you and your friends casually denigrate LGBT people and say how disgusting they are, what's wrong with them, or they're mentally ill, and you don't at least clear your throat and say, actually, why do you feel that way? On the basis of what? Because they're just trying to live their own lives. As all the evidence demonstrates, they're no threat to anyone. Then, A, you're not only not an ally, but you're passively allowing homophobia, transphobia, and so forth to exist and to promulgate in the world. So try and, like, fight the good fight, because the 1% of the human population that is gender variant, the 10% of the human population that is LGBT, we cannot fight this fight on our own. We need the other 90% to kind of, like, at least those of you who, you know, don't hate us, to stand up and do something to help. And you're not just helping us, you're going to be helping ourselves, but I've covered that in another video. Technically, the laws may exist to protect us, but that means nothing if society continues to demonize us. And in the UK at the moment, and for the past few years, we've been seeing heavy demonization of trans people in particular. And that's across all the mainstream media. It's not like it's only the right-wing media that's doing this. And it's being egged on by a government, a highly conservative government of Tories, that absolutely hate LGBT people and are trying to dismantle what few protections and rights exist for us. But anyway, to bring you up today with the latest kind of important news on that front, either at the end of last year, whether December 2020, or maybe it was January of this year, there was an important court case called Bell versus Tavistock. All you need to know is that it's concerned the rights of under 16-year-olds to receive puberty blockers. And mind you, these weren't ones that they were getting like on the gray market or anything. These were teenagers that basically had gone through the process, been referred to a gender identity clinic, that's the Tavistock in London, and basically followed all the procedures, gone through the psychiatric evaluations, and been determined that yes, they clearly do not identify with the sex they were assigned at birth, and therefore they're requesting, usually with the support of their parents, to be prescribed puberty blockers, to put on hold puberty, which will otherwise irrevocably change their bodies, to basically create the gender dysphoria that they will be forced to like deal with going forward the rest of their lives. Because once these changes are locked in, they don't automatically go back. The only way to fix them is surgery and other types of remediation, which again can be expensive, can take years, and in the meantime, you are dealing with people making assumptions about your gender from the way your body looks, and you have no control over that, which is soul-destroying, and in some cases leads people to commit suicide or do other substance abuse, whether it's alcohol or drugs. So, sadly, the court found in favor of the claimant, which was a parent of a child who'd accessed these services through the Tavistock, through the GIC, had requested and accessed them, and then obviously had a change of heart. So what we're dealing with now is a situation where if you're under 16, and at the time of the ruling, even if you had your parents' consent and medical supervision, the only way to get a puberty blocker to pause this irreversible process that you were about to go through against your will is to go petition a court of people with no medical expertise to approve, to decide that you're rational enough, you're competent enough to make this decision about your own body and your own future. And this falls under the remit of something called Gillick competency. And this was a principle that's held sway in the UK for quite a long time, up until this Bell versus Tavistock decision, which has thrown things, really muddied the waters. But yeah, the idea is that if you are like 14, 15, yes, you haven't reached the age of majority, you haven't got to 16 yet, but you're presumed to be competent to make certain decisions about your own body and your own future and your own well-being. And that includes things like use of contraception, if need be, like an abortion, stuff like this. And that is why this decision is so dangerous, and this decision is very much what conservatives want. And again, this reflects a lot of what's going on in America for my American viewers, where you see Roe v. Wade is basically being quietly rolled back, undermined, and defanged, basically to the point that it's becoming de facto impossible for women to get abortions under certain circumstances and certain demographics, which is exactly what religious fundamentalists and the far right wants. They want control of women's bodies, and they want to prevent women from having bodily autonomy and agency. So the problem here is the court has decided that under 16s, even if they're 14 or 15, are not capable of being competent of deciding to pause puberty so that they don't have the worst effects lock in, which will then have to be removed with surgeries. Then what else might the courts decide that 14 and 15 year olds are also not competent to do? What other rights are likely to be taken away? You have to remember this is a government that is scared shitless of the younger demographic of voters because they know these younger voters are likely to vote them out when the chance arises, which is why they're actively engaging right now in a lot of voter suppression moves to basically make it harder and harder for young people to vote. We're seeing this right now because they are so scared. But let's just reflect on this for a second, and then I will draw a line under this part of the video. If you can turn 16 and get a drink in a pub, and you're presumed to be able to like get bank accounts, and like as you get older, you basically get to the point you can serve in the military, you can vote, all of these things presume a certain level of adult competency, then how is it that 2 years earlier, or even 1 year earlier, you're presumed to be incompetent to make a decision about something that is going to affect your body and your mental well-being for life? So that's what the ruling was, and the only slight glimmer of hope in all of this is there was another court case in March found that as long as the child, the teenager, has parental consent and agreement that the parents are behind their decision to take puberty blockers, and of course medical supervision through the GIC, that court permission will not be required for those cases. But again, we live in a country where a lot of people vote Tory. There's going to be a lot of conservative families that think that their children are their property, and that they know better than their children, and that they will not give that permission to their children. So there's going to be a lot of trans and non-binary kids that basically are going to be seeking something to just like put the brakes on this, to give them time to think and figure out their gender, their sexuality, and they're just going to be denied it outright by a system that basically doesn't care. It doesn't care how many of them die, commit suicide, or fall into like lives where they're dealing with substance abuse as they try and cope with the unhappiness that's been foisted upon them. And that is the argument that you don't get from TERFs and transphobes and like people with huge platforms like JK Rowling. They don't care about the harm that their righteous position does. They're ideologues. They believe in one thing, and they don't give a shit about the evidence that proves that what they think is wrong, all the things that they fear aren't coming true, all the things that they suspect, all their bigotry is unfounded. They just want to believe what they believe, and they don't care how many children die as a consequence of their actions. So yeah, and let's be clear, if people are driven to suicide by a system that will not accept them, and a society that hates them, and let's face it, we have very good evidence that trans people in particular, and LGBT people in general, experience higher rates of suicidal ideation and substance abuse, then stochastically a certain number of those people are going to end up dead because of it, and it's all because of transphobes pushing through court cases like this, which end up in results that are highly non-optimal for human rights. Anyway, I think I will draw a line under that, but it's not a good situation over here at the moment. But I finally was seen by the GIC, so I had to wait 3.25 years to finally get the call to say, hey, we'll see you for your first appointment. So that was in August, and I was evaluated by one psychiatrist, and then I had to come back a bit later, like 2 months later, 1.5 months later, to have my second independent psychiatric evaluation. They both came back with a diagnosis of gender dysphoria or gender incongruence, whatever the cool kids are calling it nowadays. And at that point, naive, optimistic Zoe asked, oh good, so you both agree on a diagnosis. Can I speak to your specialist now? I'd particularly like to speak to your endocrinologist because I've tried these things. I've kept a spreadsheet of all my hormone regimens and everything I've done. I really want to know what's gone wrong because my body like started to do stuff and then kind of just stopped. I'd like to get things kickstarted again. And like the psychiatrist didn't laugh, but he's like, oh no, we don't have a staff endocrinologist. And I just like literally was like this dead silence for a moment while I had to like absorb that, going, What do you mean you don't have a staff endocrinologist? You're a GIC. There's only like 10 of these across the entire UK servicing a population of like 67 million people. You're telling me that you can't afford one endocrinologist for the entire gender identity clinic? I mean, that would be across the UK. That would be employing 10 people. Apparently, no, that's too much to ask. That's too much resources to provide for transgender healthcare in this country. So basically, no, it's like, oh no, as your psychiatrist, I'll prescribe them. It's like, okay, well then what would have stopped my GP from prescribing them? Because you have no endocrinology training. You have no specialist training in this field. Like, I'm sure you're just reading from the WPATH guidelines, which tell these are like established international guidelines for transgender healthcare. You're just going to go and say, oh, it looks like we should start with a starting dose of this for estrogen and a starting dose of this for the antiandrogens and blah, blah, blah. It's like, that same web page can be read by my GP in under 5 minutes. So all of this, like, telling me, oh no, your GP just lacks the expertise necessary to deliver transgender healthcare. You will have to wait 3 to 5 years to be seen by a gender identity clinic where the specialist will be there to give you the healthcare you need. It's like, it's all just a lie. I mean, it's all there designed to increase the amount of time you spend waiting to get anything out of the system. And there's going to be a lot of people who fall through the cracks in the interim. They just can't hold it together for 3 to 5 years waiting for any help whatsoever. And I guess the system's happy with that. The NHS doesn't really care what happens to those people who cannot survive the wait to be seen. But it's all based on a lie because, yeah, there's no staff endocrinologist. I asked about their speech and language therapist, their SALT. And they're like, oh, well, she's not technically our SALT. She's a consultant, much like the psychiatrist who's a consultant. There are no specialists at the GIC. It's just a fiction. It's just something to make you wait. And yeah, they're like, well, she took a year of maternity leave, so she's a bit backlogged on new cases. She won't be able to get you an appointment for at least another 2 years. That's on top of the 3.25 years I'd already been waiting to be seen at the GIC. So 5+ years to actually receive any voice therapy. So I'm glad I started before then, otherwise I'd just be like crying now. So no staff endocrinologist, no staff voice therapist. And as for things like facial electrolysis, which again, you have to wait to be seen by the GIC, have them approve you, refer you, and then the NHS Trust will basically sign off on giving you the authority to have electrolysis done. That's not exactly a complex procedure. It's not like the NHS does it themselves. They don't have NHS electrolysis. They just send you out to private companies with like a letter that says we will cover X amount of funds towards removing facial hair from this trans woman. By the way, the amount that they authorize is, I have it on good authority from my electrolysis and from the other 6 or 7 I spoke to, that it's like somewhere below a quarter, maybe a fifth or a sixth as much money as you actually will need to fully clear the average trans woman's face. So yeah, that's kind of where things are at. I had to fight for that. I spent 4 months after I'd gone through the evaluations at the GIC, after I'd been approved for everything, after they're like, yep, you're one of our patients now, just tell your GP to do these things and blah, 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 blah. I was told like that I should be able to start on the hair removal, and the letter just never came, and I was bothering the NHS Trust for like ages by email and phone calls. They wouldn't return any of this. I had to get the GIC to pester them. I tried getting my GP to do it. So all of this, I finally got the letter like in late November, by which time we were going into lockdown and it was too late to actually get anything done. So at that point, there's another process that the electrolysis, the private practitioner, the clinician has to like put in a request, say, I've got this letter from this patient who's been authorized to get this treatment. Will you sign off on this plan and confirm that when I complete this course of treatment, you will pay me for my services? And apparently that takes months as well. But we were in lockdown, so it didn't really matter. And we've been in lockdown until very recently. So literally, I have only just had my third electrolysis appointment last week. So yeah, it's slow going, but I guess it's better than nothing. I'll take it. But I do want to confirm for anyone waiting in the system or contemplating waiting in the system to be helped by the NHS for transgender healthcare, it's all deliberate gatekeeping and delays for no reason whatsoever. There's no justification. Like, even the speech and language therapist, I said, well, I guess I'll have to wait 2 years to see her. And the psychiatrist said, oh, well, or you could just, like, ask your GP to refer you to a local SALT. I'm going, but I was told that I couldn't do that until the GIC had seen me. And he's like, oh, that's okay. I'll put a note in your file saying we've authorized them to do that. It's like, so at any point, all of these services that I'm getting, I could have got 3.5 years, 4 years ago now, without this pointless delay and wait that has been imposed by the NHS. So anyway, I don't want to sound like have an axe to grind with the NHS. I realize that they are being deliberately underfunded by our government. I mean, it's been over a decade of austerity, brutal austerity, by the Tories, by the Conservatives, on the people. I mean, it's not austerity for them, the ruling class, the political class, they vote themselves pay raises. But for the rest of the population, yeah, just kind of like it or lump it is their philosophy. And I realize that they are deliberately underfunding lots of social services so that they will fail, so that they will have an excuse to then privatize them, sell them off to their rich mates and their corporate friends and their billionaires and CEOs of various places. We understand how this works. I wish people who voted Tory understood how it works, that they are voting for people who hate them and will destroy them. But it's hard to make people understand when they're voting against their own best interests. Sorry, the video is getting political at the very end. I will rein it in. But yeah, so that's everything. I have no idea how long this video has gone. I will find out when I go to edit it. But hopefully this shows you that I'm still alive. I haven't given up on making these to-camera pieces. There'll be more as we go into the summer, because obviously I'm only contracted to work while the modules I teach are in session. I don't get paid over the summer, but it does mean I don't have to work over the summer. So yeah, I'll have a lot more free time and zero income for the next few months once I've got my students through their exams. And I'll have more time to make YouTube videos, to work on my writing and other creative projects. So hopefully you'll see more of me in the weeks to come, definitely in the months to come. And thank you for hanging in there, those of you who are staying, those of you who've only like subscribed because you saw me playing Beat Saber and thought, she's pretty good at that, that's fun, and are now totally freaked out that I'm trans. Calm down, it's okay. Same person who plays the game. You can continue enjoying the videos. You don't have to watch these to camera pieces if they freak you out. But hi, this is who I am. And I think that about covers it. So I will hope to see you all soon-ish in another video, and take care of yourselves. Bye-bye. Well, wasn't that fun? If you agree, there's a few things you can do, like click the like button or leave me some feedback as a comment, or subscribe if you're not already subscribed to my channel. All of these things help. And if you'd like to move beyond that and support the channel and the videos I do in a more substantive fashion, I've listed a number of sort of donation options here on this final slide. Right, I think that's about it, and I'll look forward to seeing you all in future videos. Take care.